what was it, 5 days, I think, the walk through swampland. But then this, wonderful, sudden, extraordinary feeling, I think, because for months had no rest for the eyes, no wide spaces. Marvellous suddenly coming across this. And almost a perfect oval. And only, what, 8 miles across or so. But magical and impossible to tell distances. And indeed, river cormorants flying past look like pterodactyls. And there's a huge bat, Hypsignathus, monstrosus, I think. Anyhow, big snooter. And an enormous wingspan. And you think, if you're going to have a monster surviving from the wipeout of 67 million years ago, this would be the place. But there were bad things about it, like Doubla, I'll show you, introduce you in a moment. But when his spear went into the lake, he's very, very strong. So say it was 8 feet long, and give it a foot into the mud. Well, it was obvious that this lake, you know, it's 4 feet deep. So probably very flat dinosaur, what do you think? And so that was a bit of a disappointment. I was so proud of this picture. And then my wife, Belinda, said, yeah, well, it's fine, but it could be in Switzerland, she said. Now, this is the chief's favourite, Vicky. And he loved flowers. But there was always screams coming from his house in the evening. And he said to me, well, Redmond, it's because I have a very young wife and she needs correction. And one day, well, I was absolutely lost in the forest and I was very pleased that in the evenings she screamed and from real volume. Because then I realized which direction the village was and I could get back there. And I was saying to myself, please, please keep beating her. well, yeah, I'll tell you about Lake Tele after this and show you some filthy objects. But this little guy I fell in love with, baby gorilla, and he'd seen his mother speared in front of him and cut up into steaks. And I got him, I refused to pay anything for him. I just didn't do that. And I had diarrhea and he had diarrhea and we slept wrapped up together in a tarpaulin. And he was the kindest person I met in the Congo. He was consistently lovely to me at all times. And once I'd worked out that, of course, he'd be hanging around his mother when he wanted to defecate, so he'd make these little squeaks, and I'd get down on all fours, and then there was no problem. Well, just on the floor of the hut, but not on me. Oh, look. Now, you see how small he is? But even at that, oh, this is the schoolmaster's hut, and they'd actually got some bricks, I mean. That's got mango and our rest of our powdered milk and pineapple in it. And nothing I could do. He thought it was really funny. There'd be some left in the bottom, and he'd grab it, and his legs are really powerful. And then he'd face that way as if he was going to, and then pop, drop it all over me. And then go, which is, that's a gorilla laugh. And if you jiggled him up and down and kissed him right on top there, he'd smelt of fresh leaves just on the top. And then I got him out, eventually abandoned everything really, got him out to Aspinall's orphanage in Brazzaville, and I've had a wash, and this is the reunion. And I sent him postcards and nappies. He's wearing a nappy there, you can't see, but that was a great improvement. And trouble is, they're like us, they're only perhaps more sensitive. He was the first gorilla in there, got all the attention, and then other baby gorillas came in, and they were all equally traumatized. And he just couldn't take the social competition. And he died of a burst ulcer, you know, just like us, a duodenal ulcer from anxiety. Yeah, pretty sad, but beautiful.